feel the world is broken? Do you feel the shadows deepen? But do you know that all the dark won't stop life from getting through? Do you wish that you could see it all made new? Is all creation groaning? Is a new creation coming? Isn't glory alone to be alive within our midst? Isn't good that we remind ourselves of this? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He's David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this? He is. Does the Father truly love us? Does the Spirit move among us? Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those he loves. Doesn't God intend to dwell again with us? He does. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us the kingdom of priests and God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of this? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? He is. He is. He is worthy. He is worthy. He is. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hope. we've hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty infinite Father, faithfully loving your own. Here in our weakness you find us, falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men.
Lord, thank you that you have rescued us. You have pursued our hearts, and you have chosen us to be part of your family. And even though we have an enemy that comes against us, you are a mighty fortress, and we can trust in you, Lord, to defend us.
A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amidst the flood, our mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe does see to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and are with cruel hate. On earth is not his ease. Dare we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. We're not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Just ask who that may be. Christ Jesus, it is he, the Lord of hosts, his name. From age to age the same, and he must win the battle. And though this war with devils fell should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God hath will his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fail him. A mighty fortress, a rock unfailing, the King of glory forever, amen. For endless ages, and through praises. The King of glory forever. Amen. The word above all earthly powers, no thanks to them abided. The Spirit and the gifts are ours through Him who with us sided. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also, the body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever. A mighty fortress, a rock unfailing, the King of glory forever. Amen. For endless ages, enthroned in praises, the King of glory forever. Amen. A mighty fortress, a rock unfailing, the King of glory forever. Amen. For endless ages, enthroned in praises, the King of glory forever, forever. Amen.
Dear Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for the message we're about to receive. We pray for Pastor Phillip, that you would bless him with your Spirit and that he would teach us what you have given him this week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. We're going to continue our study in the book of Hebrews. This is part 7, and we're going to continue on in chapter 3 and finish chapter 4. So why don't you join me turning in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 3. And we left off on verse 13. Hebrews 3:13, which says, "But exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin." And we closed with a reminder that you have a calling. You have a responsibility to fulfill this, meaning to exhort one another daily. It's not solely the pastor's job. The elders of a church, the pastors of a church, the leaders are called to be examples to the flock. So yes, they need to continue to exhort, but the call here is for all believers to exhort one another. This is how we help each other stay on the right course. Now, something I didn't have time to touch on last week in this statement is what it mentions about the deceitfulness of sin. It says, "But exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin." And before I talk about this, let me first encourage you that in all the warnings and the exhortations that we have and will continue to encounter in the book of Hebrews, there are even greater encouragements that God has better things for us who believe. And as I said in the introduction to the book of Hebrews, that this book is ultimately a book of encouragement for Christians to stay the course, to persevere in the Christian faith, and it's entirely possible with God's help. Let me just give you some of those encouraging words that we have coming up, which we'll be looking at today, Hebrews 4:16, the end of chapter 4. It says, "Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain help," or obtain mercy, "and find grace to help in time of need." Even the author of Hebrews acknowledges that with all of these warnings, all these exhortations, that in the way he's teaching can sometimes maybe come across as overly heavy with all these warnings. Yet, look at what He says in Hebrews 6, verse 9, he says, "But beloved, we are confident of better things concerning you." Yes, things that accompany salvation, though we speak in this manner. What does he mean, though we speak in this manner? Well, all these warnings, all of these exhortations, says, yes, these are necessary, but we're confident of better things concerning you. Hebrews 6:19 is also an encouraging word. It says, "This hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which enters the presence behind the veil." And there's more than that. So don't lose heart. Don't get discouraged. The end goal of the book of Hebrews is to encourage you, to help you understand that you can stay the course, even when you see, or if you see, others around you getting off course, or even if there are those that are trying to pull you off course. But before we get into that deep and moving encouragement at the end of chapter 4, we must take heart the sincere and the helpful warnings given to us. And as I mentioned in verse 13, the subject of the deceitfulness of sin. You see, sin is not benign. It affects us. Our hearts can be hardened because of it. Our hearts are hardened because of it. And the more we sin without repentance, the harder our heart becomes. And why is it called the deceitfulness of sin? Well, because one of the reasons is we're made to think that it doesn't matter, and we can continue without the negative effects of sin. We are deceived. It is deceitful. Now, I've known many Christians over my lifetime of nearly 50 years now who at one time had a soft heart towards the Lord, but do not have a soft heart today and are not walking with the Lord. Some of them, sadly, are vehemently opposed to God. Now, this is challenging because if I witness this reality in the world, which I have, but if for some reason I couldn't find any explanation in Scripture for what I witness, it would certainly be perplexing to me. But on the other hand, it would be equally perplexing if the Bible explicitly said that it is impossible for Christians to experience a hardening of their heart through the deceitfulness of sin, and because of their drifting and an evil heart of unbelief, that they would depart from the living God. So if the Bible explicitly said that that was not possible, that would be, I'd kind of go like, wow, that's what the Bible says, and I need to believe it, but that's not what I see in the world. So it would be perplexing because of what I've seen. Nevertheless, if the Bible explicitly stated this, I would believe God, even if my experience seemed to point in a different direction. That's how much I trust God's word. But the reality is that what I have witnessed, and maybe you have witnessed in your life, over the years, in some people, is also described, verified, and explained in the Bible, especially in this book of Hebrews. And, you know, Christians sometimes ask, well, you know, can a Christian fall away? And my response, somewhat tongue-in-cheek, is, you know, why would you want to? You certainly don't have to. That's what this book is about. You know, you can stay the course. And God has given you the ability, and he's there to help. And there's so nobody is going to make you fall away. Satan can't make you fall away. God doesn't want you to stop believing in his son. God is on your side. He has promised not to forsake us. So let us hope and pray that the examples are few and fewer in our lifetime. And one of the ways that we can be helping others is to exhort one another daily, as it is called today. And part of that exhortation is not to be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. So we need to speak truth, and we need to speak truth in love. So that hardening of the heart due to unrepented sin leads to a heart of unbelief. And in the words of the apostle in the book of Hebrews, we've already studied this. He talked about that the result of that is they depart from the living God. Those are not my words. Those are the words of the apostle. Now, in verse 14, let's look at verse 14, chapter 3, verse 14, it says, "For we have become partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end." Now, we first became acquainted with this word partaker at the beginning of chapter 3. So let's go back and read that. Chapter 3, verse 1, it says, "Therefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling." So we looked at that last week, partakers of the heavenly calling. And now in verse 14, it says, "For we have become partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end." The word partakers here, it means in the original language, a partner or a companion or a fellow worker. It's the idea of participating. We're participating in some way. Well, in what way are we participating? Well, we're told in what way we're participating. We're by holding the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end. That's our participation. This is about our trust, our belief in Christ. It's not about works. The author of Hebrews doesn't say we are partakers of Christ if we attend church 52 times a year, if we pay our tithes, if we serve in the soup kitchen for the homeless, if we volunteer for a parachurch ministry in our spare time, and so on. These are all good things, but they're not how we are united with Christ. It is not how we become his companion, his fellow worker. It's not how we partake of him. We partake of Christ through faith, our belief in him, and our confidence of salvation through Christ. And so this point is clearly made as we read to the end of the chapter. So let me just read verses 15 through 19. It says, "While it is said, today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. For who, having heard, rebelled? Indeed, was it not all who came out of Egypt led by Moses? Now with whom was he angry 40 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose corpses fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but to those who did not obey? So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief." They could not enter in because of unbelief, and that's the warning here. It was not because of a lack of good works or that they had committed bad works that could not be forgiven. It was because they did not believe God, and their lack of belief resulted in disobedience. That's, you know, we don't want to put the cart before the horse, you know, so the horse leading is unbelief, and it pulls the cart of disobedience. So let me just remind you again that these warnings here are leading up to the teaching about entering God's rest, which we heard a couple weeks ago in person when our guest Steve Gregg taught on that subject, and then I gave a quick overview of it last week. But the warnings against unbelief, drifting, departing, not holding fast, not giving earnest heed. This is all the language of Hebrews. I'm not inserting that language. I'm drawing out that language. I'm presenting what the book itself is saying. All these are warnings of what might happen, but they are leading up to a positive statement, the good news. And sometimes it's necessary to understand the potential bad news before you can rightly comprehend the good news. And there is good news here. God has made a way for you to enter his rest and to enter rest from your insufficient works and rest in the sufficient work of Christ. But this involves belief, steadfast belief in Jesus Christ. That is what we are called to do. There's another hold fast in this chapter. Actually, it's hold steadfast. And early on, he used this similar terms, hold fast. But look at verse 14. For if we have become partakers of Christ, if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end. Now, there's a lot of repeat things in the book of Hebrews that is building one thing upon another. And so you might remember or recall that in chapter 3 at the beginning, it said, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession. So this is speaking about Christ, but there's something about our confession. This word confession comes up again in this verse 14. If we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end, partakers of, so this confidence in our, what is this confession? Your confession of Christ is not something you do once in your lifetime. It is not something you hold fast once and then you stop holding fast. It's something that you hold fast means you start and you don't let go. See, Jesus is the Son of God. That's our confidence, steadfast to the end. That confidence in our confession that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, our apostle, our high priest. We follow him. We listen to him. We obey him. You know, Jesus is everything to us. That should be evident in our lives. But in this context of Hebrews, the Jews in Judea were tempted to go back to Judaism. And in doing so would be denying. They would not be holding fast their confession from the beginning. There is a beginning point of your confession. There's a beginning point to my confession. We start at some point in our life by making that confession. Sometimes it's at a very young age. Sometimes it's later on in life, but we come to the realization and we repent of our sins. And you know, it may be at an altar call, but we confess that Jesus is the Christ, our Lord and our Savior. And this is the part that baptism in the New Testament kind of plays as a public confession. Today, you know, the altar call as well as baptism, it has that focus, that initial confession. But you don't just confess Jesus at the beginning and decide it's not a big deal to no longer confess him as the Christ, the Lord and the Savior for the rest of your life. Now, let's continue on in chapter 4. And I'm going to read verses 1 through 7 without really giving any commentary because these verses were already covered a couple weeks ago by Steve Gregg. And so I'll read them and then we'll pick up in verse 8 in the verses that he did not cover. So it says, therefore, since a promise remains of entering his rest, let us fear lest any of you seem to have come short of it. For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them. But the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. For we who have believed do enter that rest, as he has said, so I swore in my wrath they shall not enter my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. For he has spoken in a certain place of the seventh day in this way, and God rested on the seventh day from all his works. And again, in this place, they shall not enter my rest. Since therefore it remains that some must enter it, and those to whom it was first preached did not enter because of disobedience, again he designates a certain day, saying in David, today, after such a long time, as it has been said, today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. So once again, a reminder that we can enter God's rest. And we do that by faith. We do that by belief. But in verse 8, we're going to continue on this theme that we have seen beginning in chapter 1 about how Jesus is greater than all the things in Judaism that were important and were great. So in this case, we're going to see that Jesus is greater than Joshua. So in verse 8, it says, "For if Joshua had given them rest, then he would not afterward have spoken of another day." And what that's a reminder there. Joshua brought the next generation after the Exodus into the Promised Land. They settled, they built their cities and villages, and eventually they rested from their battles and their war to take the land. Now, what the author of Hebrews is saying here is that when you look at the psalm that is being quoted here, Psalm 95, that there's still a mention of this rest. And had Joshua given him that rest, then why is there still a mention of the possibility today, if you will hear his voice? So still a possibility of entering that rest. It wasn't about just settling in the land of Israel. This was a different rest. But let's keep reading. Verse 9, it says, "There remains, therefore, a rest for the people of God. For he who has entered his rest has himself also ceased from his works as God did from his." So we need to be diligent to enter that rest. It says in verse 11 exactly that. "Let us therefore be diligent to enter that rest, lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience." So we need to be diligent. Now you might think, diligent to enter rest? That seems counterintuitive. Why is diligence required to enter rest? Well, it's not counterintuitive. It's biblical truth. It's an eternal reality. The rest is God's rest, and he made a way for us to join him in that rest from our works. How? Well, that's through faith in his son Jesus. And genuine faith is also a continuing faith. Faith is something that's faithful. It is sustained. But if faith is not continued, it is no longer faith. You might only need a mustard seed, which Jesus talked about, a mustard seed of faith, a small amount. But if you at some point say, "I'm letting go of the mustard seed," then you no longer have it. It's no longer faith. It's about faith can only be defined as a continuing reality. Faith is faithful by its nature. It's something that is sustained. And let me use marriage as an illustration of this, because marriage begins with a wedding. But does the wedding fully define a marriage? Clearly not, when there are so many marriages today that end in divorce. So we see that the wedding is a starting point. It's the place where a pledge, a promise, a covenant to be faithful begins. And that covenant to be faithful is a covenant to be faithful until death. Now, if you break your covenant, you are no longer faithful. Whatever you pledged at the beginning, that faith that you professed, is proven at that point to be false. Because the required faith is not faith for a moment. It's not faith for a year. It's not faith for a decade. Faith, it's faithfulness for a lifetime. That is the nature of faith. Now, in verse 11, it says, at the end of verse 11, "lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience." Lest anyone of who? Well, anyone reading this letter. He's writing to Christians. It's lest any one of us find ourselves in this place because of unbelief, which leads to disobedience, and then not remaining in God's rest, not entering his rest. Now, verse 12 Let's read this. It's a very familiar passage out of Hebrews. Verse 12. For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. This is a classic Bible memory verse, but I want us to pause to consider why the apostle says this in this particular case. Why does the Holy Spirit make this emphasis at this point in the epistle to the Hebrews? Ultimately, you know, for us today, to us. Well, the intent of this verse, as well as, you know, verses 12 and as well as verse 13, is to make it clear that unbelief in the heart is not hidden. You can't hide it from God. You can't just harbor unbelief and think, you know, God doesn't see it. He doesn't really know. Unbelief is not an acceptable excuse. Why? Well, let's focus on this statement, the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. I want you to remember how the book of Hebrews begins. In Hebrews 1:1, it says, God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in time past to the fathers by the prophets. It's all about God speaking. That's the word of God. The word of God was spoken through prophets. It was spoken through Abel, through Noah, through Abraham, through Moses, through Samuel, through David, through Isaiah, through Jeremiah, and so on. All the prophets, they spoke the word of God. And that is why we have the Old Testament. But God wasn't finished speaking when he spoke to the prophets. And in fact, the prophets were, I guess we could say in today's modern language, kind of the opening act for the headliner, Jesus Christ. So in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 2, that's why we read that in verse 1, he says, God spoke in times past through the prophets. It says in verse 2, in these last days, spoken to us by his son. He has spoken to us by his son. So the emphasis of the word of God in the book of Hebrews is what God spoke through his son, and that what his son spoke is more important than what he gave the prophets to say. And that has been the focus in the book of Hebrews, how the superiority of Christ over the prophets, over the angels, over Moses, over the high priests, over Joshua now. So if there is unbelief lurking in your heart, God knows it. And it says in verse 13 here, he is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. He knows what's in your heart, and he can identify unbelief. So the temptation of the Jews in the first century to dismiss what God had said through Jesus because of unbelief is not justifiable. And that's the argument that's being made. So in verse 13, it says, there's no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account. So God's word has gone forth. It has been demonstrated through the prophets in the past. And then the height of his word being revealed is Jesus Christ. So essentially, everyone who has heard the word of God have two choices before them. You have two choices before you. You can either enter God's rest by believing in Jesus, the Son of God, the promised Christ, or not enter God's rest because of unbelief. And we know that unbelief, once again, leads to disobedience. The horse of unbelief leads the cart of disobedience. And here's the main point that was stated earlier, that unbelief is evil when you consider that God has spoken clearly what is true. And having heard what God said, if in turn you reject it and think your own ability to think for yourself is greater than God's, well, the Bible just simply says that's evil. That's an evil heart of unbelief. God, who gave you the ability to think, to hear, to know, in order to believe him. So the book of Hebrews is just chock full of these exhortations, and we're going to come across some really strong ones in the chapters ahead. But we must not be put off by them. They are meant for our good, and they are coupled with positive blessings that are given to us. And now let's turn to the blessing of steadfastly believing in Christ. You see in the book of Hebrews, there's clearly two paths being presented for the Christian. But let's look at verse 14. This is very encouraging. Chapter 4, verse 14, it says, "Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession." Now, as we consider this, it's using some language that the Jews would definitely be familiar with, because the Jewish high priest in Aaron's line went into the Holy of Holies once a year in the tabernacle and then subsequently the temple. When the high priest would do that once a year, he'd have to pass through this veil between the holy place and the Holy of Holies, or also what's known as the holiest of all. He would go in there, he would perform his duty, he would come out, and then he would have to perform the same ritual the next year and the next year and the next, because it didn't actually resolve the problem once and for all. Now, what we're reading here in Hebrews is that our great high priest, Jesus, he didn't pass through the veil in the tabernacle or the temple into a little room, a small little room. It says that he passed through the veil of heaven into the actual throne room of God and has sat down and remained in the true holiest of all of places. See, the Holy of Holies in the temple was an inferior type of the actual holiest place in the universe, which is in God's throne room and his presence. And Jesus is sitting down in that place at the right hand of God. And this is one of our motivations for holding fast our confession. But there's more encouragement to come. That's encouraging enough. The high priests for the Jews, yes, that was significant, but certainly not as significant as what Jesus did in passing through this veil of the heavens and sitting down. And now he's there all the time, and he's not working. He's not having to go back and make another sacrifice. He offered his life once and for all. So here's some other good news, that our most lofty high priest, the great high priest, who is sitting in the holiest place of all, we are told he sympathizes with us. He sympathizes with our weaknesses. So look at verse 15. "For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin." So Jesus came and he dwelt among us, and it says, in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Now, in the book of Hebrews, there's a particular focus on temptation here. And what is that focus of temptation in the book of Hebrews? That is the temptation to not believe God's word through Jesus. Now, what did Satan tempt Adam and Eve with in the Garden of Eden? It was to not believe what God had said. And Satan did that by distorting what God said, by taking it out of context, by implying things that were not true, subtle, crafty, deceitful. Now, what did Satan tempt Jesus with in the wilderness? Well, same thing. Satan distorted God's word to attempt to cause unbelief in Jesus, to get off course was the temptation from what God had clearly said to be true. And Satan did that through using God's word out of context and in a distorted manner. So we have a high priest, and he has been tempted. And he's been tempted in this particular area also. He's been tempted with this temptation of unbelief, but he withstood that temptation, and without sin is now our high priest in the holy place, and he sympathizes with the struggle. So verse 16, it says, "Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." So we've seen warning after warning, but now we have the solution, the knowledge of how to keep on the right course, even when under pressure, even in our weakness. It is true, and you have a promise here to find grace to help you in the time of temptation, that temptation to doubt God's word. And there are two diverging paths that are clear. Unbelief, which takes you off course, or belief, which is continued belief, which leads you to the throne of grace to apply for help, to help from God, help from Christ at his throne. And we can boldly go before him and ask. So this is the encouragement for us today. It's not that we will never struggle with temptations of unbelief. It's that when you do, what you need to do is go to God. Go to Christ. You have access. He is your high priest. He sympathizes with you. He understands. And it says that you will find mercy from God and you will receive grace. So mercy is that comes from this understanding of our weaknesses. And that grace is that positive ability that he gives us to be able to stay strong in our faith. Jesus Christ, our high priest, sympathizes with you. And he is sitting because his work is done. And it is effective to save you as well as to sustain you. So believe it and never stop believing it. That's where we'll close today. Look forward to getting into chapter 5 with you next week. God bless you.
This is a song I want to share with you. It's one that I wrote the same year I moved to Texas, but before I started attending Living Water Fellowship, which is kind of funny because it's titled Living Water. And it's just born out of a prayer of my heart. And then after tasting that living water, you know, we want to share that with others. So that's what this song is about.
Drown in this ocean of grace.
a blessed week.